family, out of reach, or away from us. Please help us through hard times and times when need. Please help us get over things that we know that we might not never let go. Thank you for the offering. In Jesus' name, amen.
Okay, so ladies, come over this way so you can hear the story. Good morning, boys and girls. Okay. And guess what, everybody? What, Sister Cross? Today, Sister Leonette Clark was to do the children's story. But guess who's doing it? Sister Cross, yes. Sister Clark called Sister Cross, that's me, and said, I can't do the story. We're very far away. And I told her, don't you worry about a thing. I'll do it. Well, that was very nice of Sister Cross. But guess what? I forgot that I was to do a reading. And it said, we the people. And I said, what am I going to do? And then God said, you know what? Aren't we all people? The children are people. So we're going to do two stories in one. We the people and about this little girl. How about that? Yay, yay, okay. So February, that's Black History Month. And a lot of things go on for Black History. Oral history, and that means you're telling the story. What is oral history? Telling the story. This story is about a sharecropper. Sharecroppers, they share. But this sharecropper, he only had a little bit of land. And this is a story about that man and his daughter. He had to pick cotton on this little bit of land. He didn't make much money. He just had enough for food and to take care of his family. They were very, very what? Poor. The mother, father, and child all had to work in the cotton fields. Everyone worked. The landlord, he's the one that owns all that land, and he wants them to work easy? Nah. He wants them to work what? Hard. He's the boss, and he's called the boss man. Uh-oh. The little girl who worked in the field spent her time just a-working and a-wishing. What's she doing? Working and a-wishing, rather than thinking and a-praying. Uh-oh. Here's her story. Her name is Violet. She's 8 years old. Her daddy named her Violet because he heard that was a pretty flower, and she was a what? Pretty little girl. But you know what? Always dreaming, always wishing. Here's Violet. When I was a little girl, we walked out into the cotton fields early in the morning, and I had to pick a whole lot of cotton. But my daddy said, if you pick some cotton today, a whole lot, I'm gonna give you a great big red sucker. Oh, and she loved red. So she started picking and a picking and a what? Picking. Morning, God, this is your day. I'm your child, show me your way, amen. Then the little girl started thinking. Here's that old hot sun. It ain't got nothing to do but roll around heaven all day, that lucky old sun. It was so hot. It was what? Hot. I looked up and water was running down my face. And then I saw a dog. And that dog was lying under a bush going, hey, 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 hey. You know, like dogs do. I said, that lucky old dog, I wish I was a dog. And I picked and I picked and I picked and I what? Picked. It was hot. It was real, real hot. The water was running down my face. And I looked up, I looked high up in the sky, and there was a buzzard. You know them, some big old birds. He was flying high in the sky, going round and around, so whoosh with his big old wings. What a lucky old bird. Oh, Lord, I wish I was a buzzard. I could just fly. But I had to pick, and I picked, and I picked. It was still hot. Oh, it was so hot. The water was still running down my face. And then I saw a snake. Ooh, a big old snake, all curled up and nice and cool and laying on a rock doing nothing. Oh, Lord, I wish I was a snake. These here creatures sure have it easy. But I started to pick, and I picked, and I picked. It was still hot. Water still running down my face, and I saw a butterfly. Ooh, a pretty butterfly, just bouncing from one blossom to another. Oh, Lord, I wish I was a butterfly. Fly, little butterfly, fly. Fly, little butterfly, fly. Fly, little butterfly, fly. Way up high in the sky. Away from this here cotton fields. And I picked, and I picked. And I picked. When we finished picking that cotton, guess what? Here comes my daddy. Waiting for me was a big old red sucker. Oh, thank you, Daddy. All that old hard work paid off. I helped, I was obedient, and my daddy was happy. I helped, I was obedient, and my heavenly father was happy. Me and my daddy, we walked home from the cotton fields. It was getting cool, and the sun was going down, and the moon was coming up. No more water running off of my face. Me and my daddy was walking hand in hand. No more picking and picking and picking, well, at least for a while. No more wishing, now for some praying. All things bright and beautiful, all creatures great and small, all things wise and wonderful, the Lord has made them all. A better day is coming. You know something? That old sun wasn't so hot now that I did some praying. The little girl didn't have to wish to be anything else except who Jesus wanted her to be, just a child of God. Boys and girls, remember, for better days to come, pray. Don't bother wishing away. Oh, that was good. Two prayers. Sir, I want a girl. Oh, my goodness. Both of you come real quick. Come. No, just the two little girls. Hurry now. Come, sir. Pay attention, sir.
Okay. Close your eyes and bow your heads.
Okay, go ahead.
Dear God, help us to do what is right. Help us to listen to our parents. Help us to understand the way that you can lead us. Give us life in the name of Jesus, I pray, amen.
Close your eyes. Mm-hmm. And Jesus, thank you for this day and give us all this food and for this day, amen.
Thank you, God, for keeping us safe for everything you've done for us, amen.
Keep on praying. Thank you, boys and girls.
Good morning, everyone. Let me make something clear. I'm not Dr. Elder Martin. I'm Brother Blake. But one day, when I grow up, I'm going to be a doctor one day. Deacons. Okay. The Bible says that the earth is the Lord and the fullness of the and all the fullness, its fullness. The world and those who dwell therein. For he had formed it up on the sea and established it upon the waters. Who may ascend into the hills of the Lord? Or who may stand in his holy place? He who has clean hands and pure heart, who has not lifted up their soul to idols, nor sworn deceitfully, he shall receive the blessing of the Lord and the righteousness from the God of his salvation. See, God owns everything. God bless us with good things that we have. And he asks us to give him back 10% of what he gave us. We do not pay tithe, we return tithes. We are just stewards for what we have. God said, to show me that he loved me, give me 10% of what I gave you, and you can keep 90. God is good. Open the windows of heaven and pour out a blessing that we will not room enough to receive it. Let us pray. Our Father, God, we give you thanks for the privilege you gave us that we can be, as your people, come to you. Lord, we come to you in the name of Jesus. Lord, we pray that you will bless your people and continue to provide jobs for them. I pray that you will bless us, that the tithe and the offering that we turn this morning, that we go for the furtherance of your work, go where it needed. In Jesus we pray and thank you.
second, another minute, not an hour, another day, but at this moment with my arms outstretched, I need you to make a way as you have done so many times before. Through a window or an open door, I stretch my hands to thee. Come rescue me. I need you right away. I need you now. I need you now. I need you now. I need you now. Not another second, another minute, not an hour of another day, but Lord, I need you right away. If I never needed you before to show up and restore all of the faith that I let slip while I was yet searching the world for more of the truest friend I have indeed. You're my best friend, I know in need. I stretch my hands to thee. Come rescue me, I need you right away. The agony of being alone, fear of doing things on my own, the tests and trials that come to make me strong, the feelings of guilt, hurt, shame, and defeat, the ways of trials that beat upon me. But to know, Lord, that in you I got victory. I need you now.
Scripture reading, please. And it's coming from 2 Kings chapter 7. And I'm going to read in your hearing verses 3 to 8. And there were four leprous men at the entering of the gate, and they said one to another, "Why sit we here until we die? If we say we will enter into the city of the farming is in the city, and we shall die there. And if we sit here, we will die also. Now wherefore come and let us fall unto the host of the Syrians, If they save us alive, we shall live. If they kill us, we shall but die. And they rose up in the twilight and went into the camp of the Syrians. And when they were come to the uttermost part of the camp of Syria, behold, there was no man there. For the Lord had made the host of the Assyrians to hear the noise of chariots and the noise of horses, even the noise of a great host. And they said one to another, "Lo, the king of Israel had hired against us the kings of the Hittites and the kings of the Egyptians to come unto us." Wherefore they arose and fled in the twilight and left their tents and their horses and their asses, even the camp as it was, and fled for their lives. And for it says, and when these lepers came to the uttermost part of the camp, they went into one tent and did eat and drink and carry hand silver and gold and raiment, and went and hid it, and came again and entered into another tent and carry hands also and went and hid it. May the Lord add his blessings to this voice. Thank you. You may be seated.
Let's sing this song slowly, sweet hour of prayer. Sweet hour of prayer that calls me from a world of care and bids me at my Father's throne to make all my wants and my wishes known. In seasons of distress and grief, my soul has often found relief and oft escaped the tempter's snare by thy return. Sweet hour of prayer, let's sing this song. Slowly and softly. Sweet hour of prayer. Thank you. want to give us some news this morning that there is no power than prayer. There is no power equal to prayer. I want to let us know that as we celebrate Black History Month, let us remember that some of the songs that we sing now, Swing Low, Sweet Chariot, was a prayer. It was a prayer asking God, please come and carry us home. It was a prayer that was born out of a stressful situation. But the slaves, when they could not see their way clearly, they believed their way clearly, and they prayed. They prayed. And God heard. They got in seasons of distress, in seasons of grief. My soul has often found relief, and it escaped the tempter's snare, because the sweet hour of prayer, the author of the sweet hour of prayer, has returned today. At this time, it's prayer time, a child. I want to let you know also that the devil has decided to work havoc on us. God's people are becoming an endangered species because the devil has decided full attack. And the Bible tells us that in the last days, the devil will become as a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. So this morning, we have a lot on our prayer list to pray about. Today, we want to pray. We heard about Sister Andretti's. She's in a hospital, holding on to life. But we can go to who that is the author of life, to save life. This morning, I want to pray also for Brother Cross, because sometimes things just happen and we cannot understand, we cannot explain, but God understands and God knows. This morning I want to pray also for Stephen Stovall, his sister Meadows' brother. He's a friend of mine, and Stephen is sick and holding on. I want to pray for the sick and shut in this morning. Sometimes the people that we forget, and they sit on Sabbath morning and they cannot help themselves but to let their mind go back, and sometimes they're depressed. But I want to pray for them this morning. I want to pray for them this morning. I want to pray this morning also for my mom. Just flew back on Thursday, and my mom, she's in the hospital and still is in the hospital. However, I just got some good news text to me. They were going to do emergency surgery on my mom this morning. And my sister just texted me to tell me that the doctor said things are working out. They don't have to do the emergency surgery. Let me praise God this morning. Can I just praise God for a while? Praise God. From whom? I got to praise God this morning. So I was sitting up there, and then I got a text, and I just had to respond. And I had to go out and praise God with my siblings. You know, Brother McBean lost his brother. Things are happening. And this morning, I was talking to one of my great friends, and he told me about, I want to pray also for Sister Janet Campbell. Sister Janet Campbell, she had a stroke up in New York, New Jersey area. I want to pray for them. But church, I want to pray for us. I want to pray for us. Let's sing that song again. And if you feel impressed, I'm going to ask you to join me at the altar, where we're going to sing Sweet Hour of Prayer, Sweet Hour of Prayer, that calls me from a world of care. Join me, you could join me as we pray. You might have someone that you want to stand in the gap for this morning. I'm going to ask you to come. Just come. Just come. Just come. Bow before the Lord our Maker this morning, our Father and our God. We are so thankful that we can come before thee this morning. Great God is your faithfulness unto us. Great is your kindness towards us. Great is your goodness towards us. Great is your graciousness towards us. Great is your love towards us. And Lord, this morning, if we had 10,000 tongues, we still could not thank you. We could be like the writer who said, if all of the oceans were made of ink, we could not write the love of God. Even though the whole sky was a scroll, we could not thank you enough for what you have done for us. And Lord, today we praise your name because your name is worthy to be praised. Lord, we want to thank you this morning, not only because of what you do for us, but just because you are God. Because even though you did not do anything for us, we would still praise you because you are God. We are thankful that you have thrown in graciousness towards us. And so, your people this morning, here at Shiloh and Lord, all over the world, would like to thank you for being God. We'd like to thank you for the sacrifice that you did come and you did make for us. You did come because you, the Word, became flesh, and you stooped and became us to save us. And we thank you for that. Lord, this morning, you're the great giver. You're the great healer. You're the great comforter. You who did say, "That I am." We need you this morning to comfort. We need you to cheer. We need you. And Lord, you have said just when we need you, you'll be here. So today, we need you. I want to pray this morning, special Lord, for Sister Virginia Andres. Lord, she's your servant. She's your servant. And Lord, I'm asking you to do something. Lord, you know what you're going to do. And I know you're going to do something. Because if you don't do anything, what will the heathen say? So you're going to do something. I pray this morning, Lord, and I thank you for that. I pray this morning for Sister Campbell, Lord. Massive stroke. But Lord, you are the fixer. So I'm asking you this morning, and we, our hearts, as we pray in our hearts, we are asking you to fix. But Lord, we cannot stop thanking you for what you have done for us. I want to thank you, Lord, for sparing my mom. Lord, at this time, you know we have had it. But Lord, we are so thankful that you did have mercy. And I want to thank you. I want to thank you. I want to praise your name, Lord, this morning. Lord, I ask that you will remember Stephen Stovall. Lord, he is not doing well. And Lord, he was young and vibrant just the other day, but now he's not at his best. So I'm putting him in your hands today. And Lord, the other names and the sickness that is going through this place, families and friends, Lord, and people, men heart failing them for fear, Lord. I ask that you will do something, Lord, because the time is at hand and we need, Lord, to have people on your side to be saved. So I ask this morning that you will deliver wherever you have to deliver. I ask that you'll save wherever you have to save. Lord, turn people's mind towards Christ and let them see Christ, the hope of glory. Lord, let them see him dying on a cross. Let them see him rising again. But Lord, let them see him coming back and be with him to eternity. So we thank you for that. Lord, this morning, I cannot stop but praying for the pastor of this church, for the leadership of this church. Lord, for the work that is assigned here, I ask that you will give grace, you will give strength, you'll give zeal, you'll give knowledge, but most of all, Lord, I want you to give love. Thank you for love. Lord, this morning, I want to thank you as it's Black History. For our people, Lord, who are going through way more than they can bear. Our people, Lord, who are giving up, and I ask that you will hold them, please. Please, God, hold them. But Lord, I have to pray this morning for President Trump. Lord, sometimes, most times, we cannot understand. But you have said that you rule in the affairs of men. So I'm asking you to bless and guide him. Bless and guide him. I'm asking you to teach him your way, Lord, so that he may apply his heart to love, to kindness, to diligence. Lord, this morning I want to pray for those who have placed their names in the box. Lord, their faces are different, so are their needs. And they have written their needs and have asked you to do something. So I'm asking, Lord, that your Holy Spirit who is now going through these names, thank you for the blessing that you have brought. And Lord, through the audience, your people came to the altar. We don't know what they have, Lord. I don't know, but you know. And because you know, you can do. Because you're all powerful, you're almighty, you're omnipotent, you're omniscient. And Lord, I'm glad you're omnipresent to be able to take your things here and things way across the seas. So I ask that you will bless that which they request, those that are in the audience that are asking you for something, Lord, please do. Let your Holy Spirit work with them even now. Lord, I cannot end this prayer without thanking you for the speaker of the hour. I ask, Lord, that you will reach down as you have done before and, Lord, touch him, so that it might not be him, but it might be Christ speaking through him, through the power of the Holy Spirit. And Lord, bless us that as we listen, we might get something that we might be able to go home today saying it was good to be here. So Lord, we want to just praise your name. We want to thank you, Lord, for that which you have done. We want to thank you, Lord, for that which you have already done and for that which you will do. We praise your name. We bless your name. We thank you. We thank you. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. And amen.
continue as we sing our hymn of meditation, which is Ancient Words. The words will be on the screen, and it's also in your bulletins.
I don't know about you, but I just want to praise the Lord. Have your hearts been blessed today? Amen. Hasn't the music been nice? I want to thank all of our musicians. Young brother James Fossey played the saxophone this morning. If you were here early enough, you would have been blessed by that. We appreciate our special guest, Brother James. Brother James, I talked with our minister of music, Brother Hodge, and he asked me to tell you hello. And we all appreciate you taking the time to come and be with us today. And then all of our other musicians, we want to thank Sister Rose for her ministry and signs. Wasn't that good? I tell you, God is good, and I just want to praise the Lord today. I want to say hello to my son who's streaming in and watching us from Lexington, Kentucky. And there's a few other people who said they would be watching. My daughter is here, and I always like to acknowledge her presence. And I'm just going to ask her to stand. That's my baby. And my wife, you know, she's always by my side, and I thank God this morning for her. And then I want to thank Sister Cross and the Black History Month team for asking me to be one of the speakers for this Black History Month celebration. I saw the hard work, the effort, and I've heard many of the prayers that went up to make this come together. And Sister Cross, I want you all to know that I feel privileged. And I must admit, I'm a little bit nervous because you all have coupled me with and surrounded me by so many skilled pulpiteers. On the first Sabbath of this month, Dr. Isaac Newton was our speaker. Last Sabbath, Elder Raw Granger brought us a powerful message. Let me hear you say amen. And if you were going to miss a Sabbath this month, it should have been today. Because on next Sabbath, our speaker is coming all the way from Wisconsin. And I'm looking forward to being here, not only to receive a blessing, but I'm going to ask God to help me and my wife to be a blessing to someone. And all of the speakers have been asked to deal with the subject or the theme, the astonishment. And I want you to know that this was one of the hardest sermons that I've ever had to put together, because there was so much information. Even at 4 o'clock this morning, I woke up and started reading and studying, and all of a sudden something popped up about the golden age of Africa. And I said, Lord, have mercy. How can I even get this in here? I told my wife about it when she woke up, and she said, don't worry about it. You know, you can't talk about everything. So it was difficult because there was so much information. And then I found out that the American history, some of the American history that I was taught as a kid, is a lie. I didn't know it until I started putting together this sermon. And it was pretty hard. And then not only that, I walked out the house without my glasses. Have mercy. I have about three pair up here, trying to find one, a pair of $1 reading glasses that will work and will help me. My daughter came and she just grabbed some of the old ones. She couldn't find my nice ones that, you know, fit my eyes. So she brought me something to try to work with. So I don't think the devil wants me to preach this sermon. But you all pray for me. And by God's grace, we're going to get through this. Let us pray. Father, if ever we needed the Lord before, we sure do need you now. Father, I ask this morning that you would forgive me for my sins and that you would empty me of myself. I ask that you would speak to your people, because if they hear me, they will only hear me. But if they hear the voice of God, they will hear the one who is omnipotent, omniscient, and omnipresent. They will hear you, Lord, the one who can speak words of eternal life. So do this for us, O Lord, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Our scripture for the morning was taken from 2 Kings chapter 7. And if you have your Bibles, I'm going to ask you to go back to that scripture with me. 2 Kings chapter 7, verses 3 through 8, and I would like to read them again in your hearing. 2 Kings chapter 7, starting at verse 3, the Bible says, now there were four leprous men at the entrance of the gate. And they said one to another, why are we sitting here until we die? If we say we will enter the city, the famine is in the city, and we shall die there. And if we sit here, we die also. Now, therefore, come, let us surrender to the army of the Syrians. If they keep us alive, we shall live. And if they kill us, we shall only die. And they arose at twilight to go to the camp of the Syrians. And when they had come to the outskirts of the Syrian camp, to their surprise, no one was there. For the Lord had caused the army of the Syrians to hear the noise of chariots and the noise of horses and the noise of a great army. So they said one to another, "Look, the king of Israel has hired against us the kings of the Hittites and the kings of the Egyptians to attack us." Therefore they arose and fled at twilight and left the camp intact, their tents, their horses, and their donkeys, and they fled for their lives. And when these lepers came to the outskirts of the camp, they went into one tent and ate and drank and carried from it silver and gold and clothing and went and hid them. Then they came back and entered another tent and carried some from there also and went and hid it. We've entitled our study for the day, "The Best is Yet to Come." And the setting for our sermon is clear. The Bible tells us that there were four leprous men standing at the gate of the city. The city that they came from is behind them. For you see, they were put out of that city. These four leprous men, they had been ostracized and demoralized, and they were put out of the city. They were put out of access to their family network. They no longer had access to the social media of their day because they were put out of the city. They were disenfranchised, these four men who were standing at the gate of the city. They no longer had access to Medicare, and they couldn't qualify for the Affordable Care Act because they were put out of the city. These four men who were standing at the gate, these four leprous men, they were put out of access to all the benefits that the city had, and they could no longer socialize with the people in the city because they had been ostracized and they had been demoralized. And not only that, but the people in the city had dehumanized these four men because of the dark color of their skin and because of this disease that they had called leprosy. And I can imagine if we could see them today, we would be able to see the boils and the cankers. We would be able to see the sores on these men's body. And so the people in the city were afraid of them. So they put them out of the city. They dehumanized them and they devalued them because a person's value was contingent upon what that person could do and what value that person could add to the city, to the economy. So they devalued them. And I want you to know, brothers and sisters, that no matter what a person says about you, no matter what people think about us as a people, we are special to God. All of God's people, white men and black men and Asians, we are special to God. And the Bible says that we are a chosen generation. We are a royal priesthood and a holy nation. If you believe that, let me hear you say amen. And so these four men, these four leprous men, they are standing at the gate of the city and they began to have a conversation. And in the conversation they said, "Why stand we here, lest we die? We cannot go back, for we will surely die." Because after they left the city, the Syrian army had captured that city. And if I may make an important point that came to my mind, whenever a city, whenever a country dehumanizes their people, that the judgments of God will soon fall on that country. I'm talking to somebody this morning. And so they said, "We cannot go back lest we die. And I would like to suggest to you this morning, brothers and sisters, that we cannot go back. But if we did go back in our mind's eye, how far would you want to go back? Well, this morning I would like to take us back to what history calls the transatlantic slave trade, so that I can suggest to you today that that wasn't the transatlantic slave trade. The Atlantic Ocean didn't have anything to do with enslaving people. The Atlantic Ocean could not make a man a slave, but rather it was the trans-European slave trade. That's when those Europeans, they went to Africa, they went to our motherland, and they ripped our families apart. They took wives from their husbands. They took babies out of the arms of their mothers. They took all of our resources. They stripped us of our dignity and our pride. I call it the trans-European slave trade, not the transatlantic slave trade. And then as those Europeans took the slaves from the motherland, they took some of us to Jamaica. The Akin trade, the Akin slaves from the Akin tribes went to Jamaica, and that's where Jamaica gets its name, from the Akin tribe. And then the British took others to Trinidad and Tobago. I know you know this history. We're going to get to my sermon in a minute. The British went to Trinidad and Tobago with the Congo Malente and the Lobo people. And that's where we get the name Tobago, Barbados, and Bahamas. And then they had these slaves over there start to build their roads and build their roundabouts. And after they dropped the slaves off in the Caribbean islands, then they brought them to the United States of America. This lamb-like beast of Revelation chapter 13. And instead of America calling that atrocity out, they accepted these slaves and they began to build this country that we live in on the backs of our ancestors. And then they began to set up this system called divide and conquer. I remember growing up as a little boy, going into my teenage years, people would tell me that my African brothers did not like me. And if they caught me by myself, they would kill me, and so I needed to watch my back. I remember being told that we should hate our Haitian brothers. But brothers and sisters, have you not heard? Do you not know what the Haitians did in the Haitian Revolution that ended slavery and overturned the French? And the Haitians didn't accept this yoke of bondage called slavery. They fought against it and they remained free. And then Jamaica followed, and then Trinidad followed, and then all of the other countries began to follow because of what our brothers, the Haitians, did. Come on, talk to me this morning. But I want you to know this morning that in spite of the shame and in spite of the pain, that we serve a God who sits up high and he looks down low. And they tell me that there was this strong African brother as those ships crossed the Atlantic Ocean. And I would imagine the ship that he was on was coming to America. Because he began to moan and to groan, what we call today an African sorrow chant. And it went something like this. An African sorrow chant. And the astonishing thing is while this strong African brother was down on the bottom of the ship moaning and groaning, there was a white slave master by the name of John Newton who heard this slave, and he penned the words to one of the most powerful, most popular songs in all of Christendom, Amazing Grace. Why don't you sing it with me, brothers and sisters?
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me.
maybe we don't want to go back that far. So let's fast forward through time to the days that a lot of people call the good old days, the 60s and the 70s. I tell you, I took the time to sit down in my computer and bring up a search engine, and I typed in what were the headlines in the 60s and the 70s. But before I get there, the good old days, I'm sorry, the days that we wore bell-bottom pants and platform shoes. Come on, the days of afros and afro picks. The days of 8-track tapes and the rhythm and blues. Does anybody know what I'm talking about? It was back then that Princess Elizabeth became Queen Elizabeth at age 25. The first heart transplant. Disneyland opened. I'm talking about the days that people call the good old days. Oh, I want you to know this morning, brothers and sisters, that those days were not good for everybody. That's when I Googled and asked about the headlines, and this is what came up. Birmingham church bombing. Birmingham bomb kills 4 Negro girls in church. Bloody Sunday, March 7th, 1965. Some 600 civil rights marchers were attacked with billy clubs, tear gas, and guns by Selma police. The very people who are supposed to protect us and protect them, they stopped them and they beat them. Watts riots in Los Angeles. Headline says, the black race fight for the right to work. Malcolm X, prominent leader of the Nation of Islam, assassinated on February 21st, 1965. Headlines, I want to be free. I'm a man too. We shall overcome. Our brothers and sisters, I want you to know, back then, we may not have been in chains, but we were not free. And in the midst of the tension and the tolerance of those days, God began to raise up leaders like Malcolm X, like Ralph Abernathy, like Hosea Williams, like Cesar Chavez, Coretta Scott King, Martin Luther King, Muhammad Ali, Jesse Jackson, Joe Lewis, and all of these civil rights leaders. They tell me they began to stand up for civil rights. They began to sit in for equality. And they began to march for freedom. And a man arose during that time named Martin Luther King, Jr., who preached one of the greatest sermons ever preached. I have a dream. I have a dream. But all brothers and sisters, so here we find these 4 lepers. They're standing at the gate of this city. And as they look at their circumstances and they analyze their situation, they say, we cannot go back lest we die. And they say, they ask one another, why stand we here lest we die? You know, brothers and sisters, we are at the gate of that city. We are the church in the now. We are the church of the present. We are the people for this present generation. And like those 4 lepers, we need to examine ourselves. We need to look at our situation and ask, why stand we here lest we die? We're not back there anymore. We've made progress. But you know, there's a danger that comes when a people are prosperous and don't know how to handle progress. You know, we're not back there anymore. We're not listening to 8-track tapes and albums. You know, we have iPhones now. When my daughter first got her iPhone, I walked past her room and she was listening to something. Her door was open, so I looked in looking for a radio, and she said, no, Dad, I'm listening to my iPhone. I'm listening to Pandora. I'm like, who is Pandora? Where is she? She said, no, Dad, it's an application that you can download. Back in the day, we used to, when we wanted to make a phone call, we had to look for a phone booth. Now, you young people, y'all don't know nothing about a phone booth. But you know, that was this long rectangular box, about, I would say, 2.5 feet by 2.5 feet. And if you wanted to make a phone call, you had to find a phone booth. Me and my friends would be out playing sports and running around, and when it started raining, we just started looking for a phone booth. My wife and I used to travel early in our marriage, and we need to make a phone call, and she would look in that direction, and I would be looking over here, looking for a phone booth. We've made progress. We don't use phone booths anymore. We have nice mobile phones, smartphones, to make a phone call. Some of us, or some of you, if you have it going on, you can even talk to your car. You can tell your car, call my wife. Call John. Progress. We've made progress. I remember growing up as a little boy, sleeping in a bedroom with four of my siblings. We had five people sleeping in a bed with one dresser in the room. The room was not big enough to fit anything more. So if you were the last one to get in the bed, you had to walk along the wall like this and walk over to the corner to get in the bed. But now, brothers and sisters, not only most of us have apartments and homes with bedrooms and beds that nobody even sleep in. Come on now. I'm talking about progress. We've made progress. We've seen the first African American president in our lifetime. We've seen African Americans go to the moon. We have jobs. We've made progress. But you know, brothers and sisters, there's a danger when people don't know how to handle progress and prosperity. Ellen White calls it the spirit of lethargy. Great Controversy, page 316, and Message Testimonies to Ministers, page 158. The spirit of lethargy. I had to look that word up. I had to ask my wife, what does that mean? And if I could pause for just a moment and say something to any of the young men who are looking for a wife. This is not a part of my sermon, but I just thought about it. If anybody's here looking for a wife, I know you're looking for the qualities of a good Christian woman that has the domestic qualities. That's important, pleasant to look upon. Come on and say amen. Also, look for a woman who's smarter than you. Come on, say amen. It helps. Our black women are smart. White women too, but brethren, look for a woman that's smarter than you. It will help. I'm a witness. Come on, say amen. The spirit of lethargy. We become lazy and listless because we think we have arrived. And progress can make us confuse our present where we are with our final destination. That's what I'm trying to tell you. We have not arrived, but the best is yet to come. The best is yet to come. So there's that inherent danger. There's a deceptive power in this progress that we've made. And from a spiritual standpoint, we have God's word, but we don't study it. We have the spirit of prophecy, but we don't read it. We have gotten comfortable. God has even given us the privilege to pray. Let me read this to you. In 1984, the Barna Research Group, has been compiling statistics and comparative religious practices in the United States. A 2011 statistics reveals something that's very unflattering about our church. I'm talking about our church now. They asked these Christians, these religious believers, how many times have you prayed to God in the last 7 days? That's what they asked everybody. The highest percentage came from Pentecostals, 97%. The national average for all Christians was 82%. And remember, the question is, have you prayed to God in the last 7 days? When it came to Seventh-day Adventists, only 73% of Seventh-day Adventists answered the question, yes, to have you prayed to God in the last 7 days. Now, if that doesn't sound bad to you, think of it this way. That statistic means that one out of five Adventist church members went an entire week without even talking to God. Why would that be? Surely we still believe in prayer. When our ancestors were in bondage, prayer was the lifeblood of the movement. But now, I'm talking about our church now, we have assets to manage. We have an organization to administer. We have a name to defend. We have a corporation to run, leadership issues to contend, political strategies to work out, and no time to pray. And without prayer, we lose our contact with our source. Come on, say amen. And if we are not connected to the source, like these four lepers, we can only say we will surely die. And so these four lepers, these leprous men are standing at the gate of the city. They're standing outside the gate. Because they have been ostracized and put out of the city. And they decided that we cannot go back and we cannot stay here. But then they made a move, brothers and sisters. And let me find my scripture again. They said, if we go and surrender ourselves to the Syrians, they might keep us alive. But if they don't keep us alive, all we're going to do is die. But what they didn't know, brothers and sisters, is that we serve a God who is able. A God who is able to extrapolate himself from the present. And he can move either backward or forward on this continuum we call time. And he's able to go down the road in our lives, stand where he knows we're going to have a problem. He discovers everything we're going to need to overcome that problem. And then he acts retroactively so that everything we need will be there when we get there. So just like these four lepers, I want to say unto you this morning that it's time for us to move. If we are going to be, you always hear that we need to be producers and not consumers. Yes, that's true. But we need more than that. There's a foundation that will make us strong in whatever we do. And this is what we need to do. We need to, number one, put God first. Come on, say amen. As a people who's suffering and struggling on this earth, we need to put God first. The Bible tells us to seek first the kingdom of God, and all of these things will be added. Everything else we want, if we put God first. The second thing we need to do, the second thing should be family. God first, family second. So men, that means we need to love and cherish our wives. Come on, say amen. It's not always easy. I'm a witness to that too. It's not always easy, but we have to do it. We have to love our wives, cherish our wives, just like Christ loved and cherishes his church. He says we are the apple of his eyes. We are to educate, provide for our children. We are to raise our children. God first, family second. And then education is important. I was looking at what I told you earlier, the golden Africa. And they talked about how brilliant these people were. It was our African brothers that created geometry as we know it today. And they built pyramids. One of them in Egypt is still the seven wonders of the world. Education is important. Family first, God first, family second, education, and then hard work. Come on and say amen. We cannot let this prosperity cause us to be listless. You know, there's this something I found called the paradox of our times. Paradox of our time in history. It says that we have taller buildings, but shorter tempers. We have wider freeways, but narrower viewpoints. We spend more, but have less. We buy more, but enjoy less. We have bigger houses and smaller families. More conveniences, but less time. We have more degrees and less sense. We have knowledge, but less judgment. We have more experts, yet more problems. We have more medicine, but less wellness. We have conquered outer space, but not inner space. We've conquered outer space, but not inner space. We've done larger things, but not better things. We eat more. We get fat, but we don't get strong. These are the times that we live in. These are the paradoxes, some of them, of our time. Oh, brothers and sisters, but a better day is coming. The best is yet to come. Because the Bible tells us that one day, Jesus is going to break the clouds of glory. And he's going to come and take his people home. John the Revelator says, and I saw a new heaven and a new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth were passed away, and there was no more sea. And I, John, saw the holy city, in which there will be 12 gates to that city. The streets and foundations will be made out of gold. Brothers and sisters, a better day is coming. The Bible says there'll be no more crying. There'll be no pain. There'll be no sickness. Now, we're going to struggle a little bit longer down here. And that's all right. Where there's no pain, there's no gain. But we know what to do. We know to occupy until he comes. We know to put God first, put family second, educate ourselves, and work hard. You know, nothing is going to be given to us free. And so, as my brother gets ready to come and play an appeal song, you know, I've always wished I could end the sermon powerful. You know, have people standing up clapping, saying hallelujah and praise to God. But I can't do it. I can't do it. But God is good. So let's listen to Brother James. amen. Now, I can't sit down without making an appeal. It's just something I like to do. Something we are encouraged to do. Because there might be someone here who, in spite of me, you might want to give your heart to the Lord. There might be someone here who can look past, you know, Brother Ellington, and know that there's a God in heaven. You can look at the things that are happening in this world, brothers and sisters, and you know that Jesus is coming. Now, this is not a political thing, but I was told that some people with the federal government, the entire floor, someone walked in, I believe this week, and just told all of them to go home. In the State Department of the federal government. I don't know how many it was, but they were just, you know, went to work like most of us did one day, sitting at their desk at lunch, whatever they were doing. Some people came in, supervisors and all, and told them, pack your bags, you're out of here. Your services are not needed anymore. Now, I don't know how many of you have jobs, but that can happen to any one of us. And if it does, are you all right with the Lord? Do you have enough faith to know that the Lord can take care of you? You know, we all are working hard. We all have bills. It would be devastating to lose our jobs like that. But are you all right with the Lord? Because he can get us another job. We just need to give our hearts to him. This world is going crazy, brothers and sisters. I know you know it. I know you read it in the newspaper and you watch it on the news. God is telling his people to get ready. He's telling us all to get ready. The signs of the time, Jesus is saying, I'm coming. Like the parable of the fig tree. When you see the figs beginning to come on the tree, you know that summer is coming. You know that summer is nigh. So likewise, when you see these things, you know that my coming is near. And it's even at the doors. Is there anybody who hasn't given their life to the Lord that would like to do that? If there's somebody, just raise your hand. Just raise your hand. Okay, praise the Lord, praise the Lord. Well, is there someone here who, like me, want to set my priorities, set my house in order? If you want to set your house in order by putting God first, family second, education third, and hard work fourth, I'm going to ask you to stand to your feet. I'm going to ask you to stand to your feet, and I'm going to ask the pastor if he would come and just pray for his church. Is that all right? Just bow your heads with us as the pastor prays.
Thank you, Lord, for this man of God that spoke today. He shared with us what he has been talking to you about all this week. And it is true, God, we have misplaced priorities. While we're trying to get ahead in this world, sometimes we get lost. We think that we've got it all figured out. We apologize for that. We have gone without so long. We're trying to make up for it. You've given us new privileges and opportunities. We're in a much better place than we've ever been as far as worldliness is concerned. But oh God, how far we've come Don't let us lose our way now. You have always been there with us through thick and thin, from poor situations to now. And Lord, we don't want to lose our perspective on what really counts. That's why we come today. We worship today because we're prone to wonder. We're prone to forget. Oh God, help us to be caring people about people, about people. May you help us, oh Lord, never to lose being in touch with people. So God, help us. Thank you for the reminders that keeps us where we need to be, at the feet of Jesus. Help us to get there. Stay there. Help us to love you with all our heart, soul, and mind. And then help us to love people the same way. So God, when we leave this place today, put someone on our minds to call, to see how they're doing, to share this blessing we got today. Thank you for your manservant who spoke to us today. In Jesus' name, amen. 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 You may be seated. Are there?
I'm sorry. Shall we stand for the closing song? There is a name I love to hear. I love to sing its worth. It sounds like music in my ear, the sweetest name on earth.
Oh,
Father God, we thank you for, and we praise your holy name, Lord. We worship you, and we glorify your name. Lord, we thank you for the encouraging word that we hear from your manservant. I pray that you will help us to apply them to our hearts and lead them out into our lives. Lord, I pray that you will keep us faithful, that at that great reunion day, when we see Jesus face to face and go home with him with a land, to a land where God shall wipe away all tears from our eyes, and there will be no more sickness, no more death, no more pain, no more crying, but Jesus will be our great physician. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen. Have a blessed afternoon. Be seated.
As we are about ready to leave, I would like to invite you on Wednesday night. We have been having a spectacular Wednesday night prayer meeting. Elder Bernard Taylor is taking us through stewardship, trying to learn how to do it God's way. We're going to give him a break this coming Wednesday night, but I want to show you something. I have a DVD on the Desire of Ages about Christ. How did they get this wrong? How did they get this wrong? This Wednesday night. Come on back to prayer meeting on Wednesday night so that we can grow together. God bless. Have a wonderful Sabbath afternoon.
I'm going up to you.